everybody. How you doing? It's Wednesday night at 8 o'clock. Oh, damn it. Hold on. Whoop, microphone just went out. Sorry. I'm trying some new software tonight. It's called Just Broadcaster for Facebook. It's version 1.8. And I've been talking to the developer and made a couple of suggestions, and he seemed responsive. I mean, we'll see if he's actually going to do anything with it later on. I hope he will. Some of the things that I kind of wanted now, as one of these days, I'll actually have like my desktop set up so that I can switch to it. You guys can see all the stuff that I've got going on here, but I'm not going to do that tonight. Sometime in the future. The program has a series of windows, just like OBS did. The big difference between OBS and Just Broadcaster is I'm actually able to kind of monitor my audio. As a matter of fact, he gave me some other suggestions. If you guys could tell me if my audio is synced up with my video, you know, this so professional in getting all of this out to you guys each week. I will do better in the future. Maybe. Yeah, no guarantees. And so Just Broadcaster. So I've got all these windows set up with video and pictures and other stuff that I want to do, including a Skype window. So at some point in the near future, I'm talking right now to a couple of people that I'd like to bring in. One of them is Melissa Davis, the Mac Mommy. And of course, we also have Ed Eisen and Warren Sklar, if they ever want to come on. Not tonight, guys. I'm still just trying to get my feet wet with all this stuff. But this is a much better program in some ways than OBS was, and in other ways it isn't. The interface is much simpler, but with that simplicity, you also get some things that may or may not work out that well. One thing I really like, you can see the lower third logo there. I can basically set that up, just hit a button, and it comes up. What I had to do with OBS was have a separate window set up with the lower third on it, hit that one, bring that up for however long I wanted the lower third on, and then switch back to the other one. And it was kind of a pain in the neck. But with this one, I just hit a button, and there's the lower third. One of the other things that this has that I've been kind of looking at and is kind of cool. I'm just going to show it to you. I can do scrolling text across the bottom of the screen. And I set this one up for Ed. So what you're going to see, there's a blue bar. Of course, you can see that. And I just put some text in there. So advertising Ed's book, Welcome to the Light Side. So make sure you go on over to Amazon or Apple's iBookstore and check that out there. If you haven't already got it, he put a lot of hard work into it. And for 99 cents, you get a book that's always being updated with new information. So that's a good thing. we have this show for this evening. This is show 3. This is March 15th, 2017. As everyone here that's in the live chat is ready to go. Oh, hey, Chase, I know you got something you want to ask me later. Not right now. We will get to it. He's asking what program this is. You must have just come in, dude. It's called Just Broadcaster for Facebook. It's up to version 1.8, and I think it's like $30. And the developer seems like, I mean, just from chatting with him in his forum, he seems to be a pretty cool guy, and we'll see if he implements some of the things that I'd like to see in the future for this program. One of them being able to have more like little windows and stuff that I can switch to easily. Right now I'm kind of limited to what I can fit on this bottom bar, and it doesn't scroll. So if I want to have more windows than like the 6 I have right now, I just have to keep expanding out the window, and it makes everything smaller and harder to see. Yeah, Warren, it's the guy program very, very much. But I mean, things like like what I just showed you with the lower third. I'll show you again, because I think this is so cool. And not only can you have them come up on the screen, but he's got like this online component where you can customize them yourself. And as you can see, it's, you know, I put the little stoned moose on there and my name and the name of the podcast. And I've got room here. I can make three of these and have them set and ready to go at any time, which is kind of great. I've got two scrolling text set up here. I don't even remember what this first one says. So I'm just going to run that one and you guys can read it. And, you know, I mean, this is all just cool stuff. I love this stuff. So that's kind of the update on how the show's going. There's one other thing. Now, in some shows past, I've worn glasses. I'm not going to wear glasses anymore because it reflects the light from the monitor so bad that it, you know, it was just kind of glaring. The other thing that I had done in previous shows, I wore a hat. I'm not going to wear a hat. And also sometimes headphones, so I could hear some of the other stuff that was going on. What I did, you can't really see it that well, but I bought this like earpiece thing here that it's somewhat subtle, and I've got the cable running down my shirt here and it's going to the computer. The only problem is the cable's a little short, and I've got a Mac Pro 5.1, and yes, Chase, we will get to your stuff in a little bit, and it makes it, but just barely, so I can't move my head too much because it yanks on my ear. One of the other things that I've got set up now through the magic of Rogue Amoeba's Audio Hijack, and for those of you who follow me or listen to the MyMac.com podcast, this will probably come as no surprise.
Of course, I'm not bright about doing things.
Yes, I have soundboard. Soundboard is up and running. So, though it is kind of weird because I have my microphone and soundboard and Skype all in this one Audio Hijack page or whatever, you know, the session. That's what they called it, a session. So that's all set up there. But because my audio is slightly delayed from the time, you know, of course, it's like 10 seconds from the time I say it or do it, and you guys see it over there on Facebook, there's even a little bit of audio delay as I'm speaking directly here in the program, which can be kind of distracting. So I actually have my audio turned off so that I can't hear it. If I turn it back on, let me turn it back on here. Now, it won't make any difference to you guys because my audio is going out no matter what, but I have all the audio muted here in the program. So I'm going to turn that back on, and yeah, it's slightly delayed. I got to turn it back off. There we go. Because I just can't deal with it. So what I may need to figure out is how to route all of the other audio, whether it's from Skype or soundboard or what have you, and have that go into like a different part of just Broadcaster so that I can still hear those. Now, some of the movie files and stuff like I do for the ads, that runs separately. And if you could see the interface, you would see that there's like five different audio bars here. And each one of these little audio bars is associated with one of these other little movie files that I'm doing, or one of these other little windows that, that I'm dealing with. So, you know, it's, it is a work in progress. But so far I like this a lot more than I did OBS. So that's kind of an update on the show itself. Something that I wanted to talk about tonight was something that it's kind of, I won't say it's near and dear to my heart because I actually can't stand it. And it's subscription apps. This is a relatively new trend in software distribution. And, you know, I get why they do it. You know, the first company that kind of did this in a big way was Adobe with their Creative Cloud suite. And the reason why they did it is what Adobe used to do. They had their CS series of programs, and depending on what your particular focus was, they had different ones for photographers and videographers and graphic artists and things along those lines. And when they came out with a new version, it'd be CS2, CS3, CS4, and on and on and on. And that, you know, this was not cheap software. It would be, if you got like the entire Adobe CS suite of programs, it would probably run you as a individual user well over $2,000. Now, if you were working in a company that needed this kind of software, well, then they would, of course, buy it for you, but they would get some slight discounts because they would buy these licenses in bulk. Well, the problem with that is when Adobe would release a new version of their Creative Suite, they would have like all these people that were updating right away. So this like huge amount of money would come in. And then as time went on, that amount of money that was coming in would start to trickle down. Well, the problem is that when you're creating software that's as complex as some of the programs that Adobe makes, and let's face it, they're, you know, first in class for pretty much everything that they do. You know, there's a reason why Photoshop is now a verb. You know, you see a picture and you're like, oh, well, that picture's been shopped. With, you know, they don't say that picture's been acorned or that picture's been pixelated or pixelator or anything along those. They say it's been shopped. Same thing with a lot of their other programs. Sorry, excuse me. So they had to do, in their minds, they had to do something. They wanted to have a more steady stream of money coming in. So what they decided to do was take all of their, you know, their entire suite of programs, make it so that you couldn't buy them as individual programs anymore. You had to subscribe to these programs. And if you pay monthly, well, you're going to pay more than if you go ahead and sign up for a year or so. You know, you'll get a little price break on that. But if you want to get every single program that Adobe makes in their CC package, it's going to cost you, I had all this written down. Let's see. $600 a year for the entire suite. Now, if your focus is a little tighter than that, like say all you need is Premiere Pro and After Effects, well, the problem was each one of those programs is like $20 a month per app. So if you only need two of the programs from their Creative Cloud, at $20 a month for each one, that's $480. And you know, you can kind of justify it by saying, well, for only another $120, I can get, you know, like all these other programs. And, you know, Adobe isn't stupid. They know exactly what it is they're doing. And the difference between $480 a year versus $600 a year isn't that much. And it doesn't cost them any more money for you to have all of their programs as compared to just a couple of their programs. Because it's all, you know, I mean, these are all just bits that you're downloading. So once all that kind of started, because I had Creative Suite, I want to say Creative Suite 5, and I didn't upgrade to 6. And, you know, this is kind of the thing. A lot of people, when they get programs like this that cost, you know, $2,000 or more, well, they buy it, they install it, and then they hold on to that program for as long as their computer can run it, or that the OS that you have on that computer will still support the features of the program. So you buy Creative Suite 4, and 5 comes out and you're like, eh, you know, 4 is okay. 6 comes out, eh, you know what? Everything I'm used to 4, I'm going to stay with 4. Well, this doesn't give Adobe any money. So they did a couple things. You know, they started these this subscription service, which gives them a steady income, and then they kind of made some changes, so-called updates, in some of the other programs that were running under CS5 and CS6. And according to some people that I've talked to, these programs no longer worked exactly as they did before. There seemed to be some kind of issue one way or the other. You know, it's not really a forced upgrade. But if you wanted to continue to have support from Adobe for their software, well, then you kind of had to update. And unfortunately for all of us, and this is, you know, just my opinion, this has backfired on users, because a lot of people now, or a lot of developers now, are going to strictly subscription services. And in some ways, Apple's App Store is like a subscription service. The main difference being that you buy a program in the App Store, and as long as that program is supported in the operating system that you're using, you never have to buy it again. You know, you get all the updates that the developer puts out, and, you know, eventually they'll say, okay, well, this is my program widget 1, and for all the super cool features that are going to work in 10.12, you'll need to go to widget 2. And, you know, that's okay, because most of the prices for programs in Apple's App Store are relatively reasonable. So as you can probably tell, I am not a fan of subscription services. And it may surprise you to know that actually there is one company and one suite of software that I do subscribe to, and my opinion, it is a tremendous bargain. The company's name is Microsoft, and it's Microsoft Office for the Mac. For $99 a year, you get the entire Office for the Mac suite, okay? And we're not talking about just one computer. We're talking about 5 licenses. You can put Microsoft Office for the Mac on up to 5 computers, $99 a year. On top of that, they also give you full access and full control over Microsoft Office for mobile, and not just for iPhones. Now, this room is a mess. I've got this little computer over here that is, it's based on Android. It's called the Remix Mini. And it's this little tiny computer. It's like the size of a hockey puck. It's got an HDMI output. It's got a couple of USB ports, audio out jack, Bluetooth, Wi-Fi. You know, yes, Ed, Microsoft Office for the Mac. But after I had signed up for Microsoft Office for the Mac, I put it on my Mac Pro. I put it on my MacBook Pro. I put it on my wife's MacBook Pro. I put it on my kid's MacBook Pro. I put it on my son Guy's MacBook Pro. I put it on my son Peter's iMac, because he didn't have a portable computer at the time. And so there was 5 computers running the latest and greatest version of Microsoft Office. I could put it on my iPad with, you know, their mobile apps. I could put it on my iPhone. But what surprised me was, after signing into the account that I had with Microsoft, I was also able to put it on this Android-based Jide Remix. And now, connected to a monitor, I had Microsoft Office, the mobile version, running on Android on a big 27-inch monitor with mouse and keyboard and multiple windows and all kinds of stuff. So there's, you know, I think maybe my main problem with how Adobe does subscription services is that, in my opinion, they're guilty of vastly overcharging for the software. And because they are the industry leader in so many ways with the software that they sell, you know, the people that depend on it, they're kind of locked into it. They don't really have much of a choice. Whereas with Microsoft Office, you have lots of choices. You've got all of Apple's programs, which include word processor. As a matter of fact, Warren is in the chat room. Hi, Warren. Is that you in there that's in the chat room, Warren? I think so. And so, you know, we're collaborating on the Mac to the Future Go podcast notes. So anything that he sees that's kind of interesting in the chat room, he can copy that, put it right into Pages, which I also have here on my monitor, and I can see him right away. So can you believe I've already been talking for 20 minutes? Yeah. So yeah, these shows will get longer as time goes on. I know last week was a little bit short. So anyway, that's kind of my take on subscription services. I think Adobe isn't doing it very well, even though they're making lots of money at it. And I think in this particular case, Microsoft is doing what needs to be done to have a oh, and you know what I didn't even mention with Microsoft service, besides all the mobile versions and all the regular versions for the Mac and mobile devices, they also give you 1 terabyte of storage in their cloud service. What is that called? OneDrive? Yeah. So for $99 a year, that's a pretty good deal. So as long as I still consider Microsoft Office as something I need and I do use it, and that they keep their price reasonable, which so far over the course of nearly 2 years they have, I'll continue to stay with them. And yeah, I know that there's lots of other options, but you know, it's Microsoft Office, so why not? Anyway, something, you know, and you know, I was just about to take a break, but then I realized I've got some other stuff here too. There's a, speaking of subscription services, there's this new subscription. Now everyone has seen these deals for Apple applications where they bundle a bunch of, you know, different programs in, and they'll have, you know, sometimes games and other things that will reveal, you know, whatever the program is for this week and however much it's going to cost. But there's a new service called SetApp at setapp.com. And these guys have, I think, 60 to 70 programs in their repertoire. And for $10 a month, you have access to all of these programs, which sounds great, except, you know, I've looked through the list and, you know, you can go to it. You can go and look at it yourself at setapp.com, and it's SETAPP.com. But the only ones that I really found that interesting, there was one called Capto, which is a screen recording and editing app, kind of like, you know, Camtasia and some of the other ones. There was one called Downy, which downloads YouTube movies. iFlix for adding movies to iTunes, which I guess kind of defeats the whole purpose of a digital store. And it'll also upload to your iOS device. There's Hype, which is an HTML5 animation app, and Rapid Weaver. And, you know, some of these programs are really good, but for the most part, they aren't something that I'm going to use every day or sometimes maybe even every week. And at that point, is it worth it for me to spend $10 a month for up-to-date applications that I'm not going to use that often? You know, your mileage may vary. There may be some apps here that you'll love, but for me, didn't seem to really be worth it. Okay. I think we're going to take a little break. When we come back, I'm going to talk about Apple Watches, and if there's time, some of the rumors of the new iPads, and of course your comments and questions in the show. We'll be right back.
Everybody, please stand by. And, well, we'll be right back.
And welcome, everyone, back to the MyMac.com podcast.
All right, so let's carry on. But
I'm still laughing about something that happened just before we started recording, and we're going to talk about that right now.
I don't know if you heard, Guy, but Sal Segoin, did you know that?
Yeah, I heard that. He's leaving Apple. It's a tragedy for everybody.
Oh dear, this is not going well, is it? We are so childish.
We really are. It's the G-Men on the MyMac.com podcast. Okay, hey, welcome back. When the Apple Watch first came out, I was not a fan. I really didn't see the point in having something on my wrist that mirrored a lot of the functionality of the phone that you had to keep with you and was right in my pocket. So I didn't bother with what's now being called, I guess, the Series 0 Apple Watch. The Series 1 didn't really add anything that that interested me. But when the Series 2 came out, they did a couple things. They added GPS and a better ability to kind of operate with the phone and things like maps and stuff like that. And I know just recently I took a trip. I put the address of where I was going in my phone, and I had my phone up. I have a little mount in my car that I set the phone in so that I can see it as I'm driving without being too distracted. And I noticed that every time I was coming up to a turn, just before the phone would say, turn right here, or turn right in 1/2 mile, my phone would, or my, my watch would buzz. And when I looked down on it, there'd be like a little arrow pointing in whatever direction it was that I needed to turn at the next one. So I have one now, and the only reason why I ended up buying it was that I got this like terrific deal on a refurbed Series 2. And I have, some of the things that I was expecting to have happen with the watch was I thought I was going to get like terrible battery life, because I know that was a thing. But when I take it off my wrist at the end of the day and I put it on the charger, I've got anywhere from 60-80% of battery life left. And that's after it, I put it on my wrist at 6 o'clock in the morning, and it stays with me, here it is right here. It stays with me all day long, all night until just before I go to bed. And that's when I put it on the charger. And it's like, with battery life that good, it would probably easily last for 2 days. But I usually don't take it that far. Yeah, Warren says he gets ladies with the watch. You're a married man. You're not fooling anybody, dude. So I have the Apple Watch, and I feel bad about it because I really slammed it a lot when it first came out. So also notifications have been really, really useful as compared to, my phone buzzing in my pocket. Is that a phone, or are you just happy to see me? And pulling my phone out, I get all my texts and notifications and stuff right here on the watch. So I'm kind of becoming an Apple Watch fan. And I know that I don't use it to its full potential, and that there's lots of things that I could be doing with it that I'm not. But I really hope that as time goes on, I will find many more uses for it, and I'm sure I will. But even just the few things that I do with it now, I'm pretty happy with it. Okay. Last thing that I want to talk about tonight is there's some rumors of some new iPads coming out, and the rumors have been kind of all over the place. Now, I'm not a fan typically of a lot of the rumor sites. regardless of how right or how wrong some of the pundits on these sites have been, when they're right, they crow about it. You know, oh, I knew about this, you know, 10,000 years ago that Apple was going to do blah, 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 blah. And I think that they just don't.
What would you do with a brain if you had one?
That if they would just stop and think about some of the things that they're putting on their site, and a lot of this stuff is just clickbait journalism. Oh, really? Oh, Ed's talking about Apple Pay. I have not yet successfully done Apple Pay through the watch. It's still, I'm still pretty much just using my phone for that. But I am finding all kinds of different things that I do use it for. But getting back to the iPad, one of the things that they're talking about is making the mid-range iPad, which is the 9.7-inch, bigger, taking that up to 10.5 inches. And, you know, I mean, okay, a slightly bigger iPad, and I'm sure it would have the same internals or close to the same internals as the current iPad Pro. Now, I have the first-gen iPad Pro, and prior to me buying that iPad Pro, I had a third gen regular iPad, and I used that sucker for 4 years, and it did everything for 4 years. I mean, I recorded podcasts on it. I everything that I was basically using a laptop for, I was able to do on an iPad. So when the only thing that I wanted that Apple wasn't offering, with, you know, the various updates with the fourth gen and the fifth gen and the Airs, was a bigger screen. That's what I wanted. I wanted a bigger screen. So when the iPad Pro came out, it was like, oh, okay, this is what I wanted. This is what I wanted. So I went ahead and I got one, and it's been fabulous. So with the bigger iPad, which, you know, was a pretty, it's, the damn thing costs almost as much as a laptop. When they replaced it not long after that, I was not happy. The big difference was they went from a top level of storage of 128 to 256. And I would have loved to have had 256 gigs of storage. But, you know, it is what it is. I don't want to complain about it, even though I'm a little bitter, because it's still a great device, and I'm loving my iPad Pro. And I can't see myself going to a new iPad that was smaller. You know, we'll see. This one of the things that I would love to see Apple do, and I think eventually they will, would be to make it so that the iPad and the iPhone really is the only computer that you need. So you've got a little dock set up at your house, and you've got a little dock set up where you work. And when you're interacting with an iPhone or you're interacting with an iPad, well, it works like a touch device. That's what it was designed to do. You get to your office, you put the iPad in a little dock or whatever, and now all of your apps and everything else that the iPad can do is on a large monitor. You have a mouse and keyboard control and multiple windows and all the rest. You know, all the room that you get with a large monitor, you can take advantage of with an operating system that you're used to using, whether it's, you know, Windows or the Mac OS. And I think eventually this is what they're going to do. I know that company I was talking about earlier, Jide, is getting ready to come out with something like that for Android, and I don't know if it will only work on Android devices that they create, or if it'll work as an app on any Android device out there. And if it does work as an app on any, you know, Android phone that's out there, this could be a serious problem for Apple. But I don't know. You know, is this something that people would like? Instead of carrying around a big laptop, you've got an iPad or you've got your iPhone. And when you get to your hotel or you get to the office or you get to home, you just take it out of your pocket, plug it in, and, you know, there's your desktop. So you're, you know, you're not trying to maintain different devices to do different things, because the one device will do it all. That's kind of what I'd like to see. Anyway, let's take a look at, I need to switch some stuff around here. The chat room, now this program, Just Broadcaster, it gives me the last 20 chats. And the chats that I'm looking at go back to when I was talking about the watch. So if there's anything that you'd like to ask me or anything that you'd like to talk to me about, go ahead and put it in and we will talk about it here. But in the meantime, because I want to be able to see some of the older comments, I'm going to bring this up. Hopefully, I'm not seeing it here in the, there I am. No, I don't want volume. I just want to see the comments. And it's not showing me all the comments. Well, that's weird. So, this is more growing pains. I need to figure out a way to be able to see all the comments when they come up. Now, I know Chase earlier in the day had asked a question, and I'm looking for it now. Here it is right here. All right, Chase, we're going to talk about what you put on the site earlier. You say that you own a Mac Pro 2.1, 8-core Xeon, all the fancy stuff. It needed RAM and a GPU, but it's very costly. That's very true. The power supply went out, and I cannot afford that on top of the parts. I've been seeing many iMacs from 2008 that run El Capitan, and I was wondering if that seemed like a good replacement, as they run for a whole quarter of what I would be dumping into my Pro and would also last a long time. I've also used an iMac and never had any problems due to them being very well built. Also, I hate the size of my Mac Pro. I had a 2008 Mac Pro, and it was the 8-core 2.4 gigahertz. You know, it had the two quad-core Xeon chips in it. And yeah, adding RAM to a Mac Pro is very, very expensive, because it doesn't use like the regular RAM that computers of that era used. It's like, there was like some kind of magic smoke that they put into the RAM for the Mac Pros. Because, I mean, basically the processors that are in the Mac Pro, those are server chips that Intel makes. Those are Xeons. They're not, at the time, like the Core 2 Duos or the quad cores or even like the i3s and the i5s and i7s that they have now. These were chips that were, designed to do a lot of heavy lifting. And the Mac Pros are very, very good at that. And I used that Mac Pro all through El Capitan, and I think just into the next version of the Mac OS. But then I ran into a really good deal on a 2010 Mac Pro. So this is either a 4.1 or a 5.1 system report. Let's do a system report, because that's exciting to do. This is a 5.1 quad core Intel Xeon 2.8 gigahertz. So it's got one processor, four cores. I've got 32 gigs of memory in it because I can. I've got all four drive bays filled. I've got a 2 terabyte SSD in my main drive, and that's what I'm running off of. And then I have three other drives, all spinny drives. Two of them I use for one of them I use for a backup of the SSD. The other is like a documents drive, and not this week, but maybe in the next week or two, I'll talk about doing backups, because I have got like this Frankenstein monster of backups. Anyway, it was a great deal, and it's lasted me a really long time. And I like the Pro. I like the fact that I can just put like tons of storage into it. And the problem with the IMAX is, especially since they've been on this obsession of them being so thin, you can't get into them anymore. You can't easily replace the drive. The last iMac that I replaced a drive in was a 20-inch, either first or second gen Intel iMac, and it was a royal pain in the ass. I mean, just not fun at all. And there were so many different ways that things could go wrong. But the nice thing about the iMacs is they are very, very powerful. And for what most people do, will last them a long time and do exactly what it is that they want. If you're not happy, Chase, because of the size of the Mac Pro, a couple things to think about. Number one, I think you're right not to bother to try to upgrade it, because getting it up to, I don't know, I don't think you said how much RAM you have in it now, but getting it up to 16 or 32 gigs of RAM is going to be super, super expensive. And you said as well that the power supply went out in it. Well, when something like that happens, there's always a good chance that it has also damaged something. Oh, you only have 2 gigabytes. Yeah. Okay. So going to a bare minimum of 8 or 16. Yeah. That's going to cost you a lot. But when a power supply goes out in a computer, especially something as big and complex as a Mac Pro, there's a very good chance that there was other damage as well. And the PSU is $300. Okay. With that being said, unless you know for sure that there is absolutely no other damage to any of the other components on this computer, I wouldn't spend $300 to fix it, because that's honestly, that's probably about what the whole thing is worth. And you can pick up a 2010 to 2012 iMac. You know what? One of the places I like to kind of browse for used Macs is Otherworld Computing at MacSales.com. And I'm going to scoot over there real quick. Let's take a look at the iMacs. Now they have got, all right, I mean, the very first one I'm seeing here, this is a 21.5-inch 2011 iMac 12.1 quad-core i5, 2.7 gigahertz, already has 8 gigs of RAM, 1 gig spinny drive, it's got a super drive, you know, everything else, $699. So basically for about $400 more than it would cost you to repair a 2008 computer that you won't be able to update to Sierra, even if you wanted to. There's a definite shelf life on the 2008 computers, because I believe they have a 32 gigabyte bus. And in order to go, I think, past 10.7, you needed to have at least a 64 gig bus, which means you needed a 2009 or better as far as the Mac Pros goes. But this 2011, it'll do everything that you need it to do. If you want a larger screen, okay, well, the same era iMac, the 12.2, mid-2011, they've got a 3.1 gigahertz i5. Where is it? Here's one, 12 gigs of memory, 1 gig hard drive, 3.1 gigahertz. It's got Thunderbolt, 27-inch screen, $999. And if you look at these, I mean, you could even go all the way up. They have a late 2014, sounds like this is the Mac Sales ad, but it's really not. I just really like the company. Late 2014, 27-inch quad-core iMac, 5K display, 3.5 gigahertz i5, 8 gigs of RAM, 1 terabyte Fusion drive, for about $1,600. And this is a computer that will easily last you anywhere from 4 to 6 years into the future. And, you know, and again, this is all guesswork, but probably 4 to 6 years in the future with Apple's updates. But you don't, I mean, if you don't need a Retina screen, you can go with like a 2011 27-inch or 21.5-inch iMac and easily use that for 3 to 4 years. So that's a good place to go. Of course, there's also Apple's refurb site. And, you know, I have bought computers off places like eBay, but you really don't know what it is you're getting yourself into. I had a problem long, long time ago with a laptop that I bought off of eBay, and it was a nightmare getting it straightened out. And if you don't have a lot of money and you don't have a lot of time, then I would recommend going with, and yeah, you will pay a little bit more than you will off of someplace like eBay or Craigslist or something along those lines. But the nice thing about most of these companies, especially Otherworld Computing, is they really, really stand behind their products. They offer warranties. They, you know, Otherworld Computing, I know, has a kind of a, you know, don't ask, don't tell, as far as if you have a problem with the computer, they'll take care of it. You know, and there's almost always someone there. I think, I know that their support staff used to be there 24/7. I don't know if that's true anymore, but it's a really good company to deal with. So I hope I've answered your question. I wouldn't bother to put any money into that Mac Pro. It's really just not worth it. Sell it for whatever you can get for it as far as the parts go. Move on to an iMac, or save a little bit more money, and you could probably pick up, like, well, I don't know if you're still interested in a Mac Pro. I picked up this 5.1 Mac Pro year and a half ago, I guess, and it was around $1,000. But it's a real workhorse of a computer. And if you could see all the stuff that I'm doing here, I've got so much going on, and this computer is just, it's killing it, you know, not a problem at all, keeping ahead of all that stuff. So that's, you know, that's my advice as far as that goes. I don't know if anyone else has anything that they want to ask me. I don't see anything else here in the chat room. So I think unless I see something like real quick, we're gonna end the show for tonight. Holy crap, we're at almost 50 minutes already. I really want to keep these shows an hour or less. So I think this is probably a good time to end it. I'd like to say thanks to Warren and Ed and some of the other admins at the Mac to the Future site. I had requested that they make me an admin, which I needed to use this program and be able to live cast directly into Facebook for the Mac to the Future site. And I will keep you guys updated on how Just Broadcaster is doing. I'm hoping to see some of the improvements that I was talking to the developer about. And, I'll keep you all informed in that. Anyway, thanks you all so very much for being here tonight. I appreciate the comments. I appreciate Warren and Ed being here that are, you know, kind of keeping an eye on the chat room. And I think with that, we shall see you all next week.